Hey, everyone. It's me, Arcanist Aranya Versarn of Wormrest Accord and Moonguard. Today is World Autism Awareness Day 2018. And this is my coming out video. When I was 12, after many back and forth car trips between my home and the specialists at UCLA, I was diagnosed on the spectrum, on the autism spectrum, with Asperger's syndrome. I was put on Zoloft, which is a serotonin reuptake inhibitor to help handle my titanic depressions and adolescent autistic moods. And on Concerta to help me focus and not be so distracted, because I was also diagnosed with attention deficit disorder. Attention deficit disorder is, it's not really anything special. I mean, you can't focus on things. You get distracted easily. You daydream easily. It's totally different from attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which creates a lot of disturbances in your life. I've known some people with it, but yeah, when I was 12, I was diagnosed with autism. Prior to that, I had had a very rough childhood as a girl, and obviously my life didn't stay that way. I know a lot of you right now may be thinking, oh my God, I had no idea. And that's okay. That's okay. But I hope that everything I am about to tell you will help you understand some things about me and about autism and autistic people, and especially autistic adults. See, when I was a girl, I had a lot of challenges relating to other kids, relating to social and societal norms. My energy was all over the place. I was always, you know, full of song and poetry I was that girl that would get picked on because I was weird. Yeah. I was that girl that was always hiding in the bushes because I didn't want to get, you know, beaten to death, whipped to death with jump ropes, or smashed in the head with a basketball. That was me. And my parents, of course, they transferred me to another school in fifth grade because I wasn't safe at my first school. My classmates were just vicious as all heck. And I found out that after I left, they turned on each other. Go figure. But in fifth grade at my new school, it wasn't that much better either. I had people vandalizing my stuff. I had people framing me for things that I didn't do because I was clear on the other side of campus when it happened, but the faculty, you know, they wouldn't believe me because I was this strange little girl. They found it harder to believe me than the not-so-strange students to them. So I was put on a special independent education plan for a while where I was collaborating with my school. You know, it was a public school, but I schooled at home and I learned a lot better. And I didn't come back to class until about sixth grade. And then when I was 12 and starting junior high, I finally got the diagnosis. And I thought, thank God, it has a name. It has a name. I can handle it now. I think, I hope, maybe. The truth is, autism, whether you put a label on it or not, whether you put a pin on it or not, it's not easy. It's just not. I had very challenging teenage years trying to connect with people. I didn't really feel like people understood me. They didn't. They could appreciate my artistic talents with poetry and writing and music, but they weren't on my level. I was on a whole other level, a whole separate world from them. But the thing is, I had a lot of support. I had a lot of support from my counselors. I had a lot of support from my family. And they always taught me, they always told me that I can do better, that I can go beyond something, that I just have to keep on trying. And by the time I was 18, I was actually pretty grounded in my life. I had gotten to where I could deeply understand myself, and I made the honor roll. I graduated with a 3.8 GPA. I was in the top 20% of my class when I graduated high school. And by that time, I could handle my life. I could handle my life despite all the challenges. And I was able to finish therapy. My last day with my counselor, I said, you know, you've been great and we've made a lot of progress over the years. I really don't feel like I need this anymore. And he was so proud of me. And then later, after I had moved in with my now ex of, he was going to be my first adult relationship of more than 10 years, but he's my ex now. I came off the Zoloft and off the Concerta. I could handle my own emotions. I was very grounded in my life. I didn't need that stuff anymore. And the thing about that, unfortunately, in my adult life, my early adult life, is that when I started talking about my journey through autism into where I was at, normal people, so-called normal people, whoop, come on, don't AFK on me, babe. Don't AFK on me. So-called normies were always amazed. They were amazed when I told them that I was autistic because I was very smart, I was very vivacious, I was very witty, and I had this intuition about other people where I could figure their intentions before they even had themselves figured. And they didn't get it. They had this stereotype about autism in their heads, so they were always amazed. And the saddest part wasn't even that. It was the families and parents of other autistic people, when I would tell them, they would get very hostile. They'd get very hostile towards me because, and this was all over the net. This was never in person. I live in person. People tend to be more polite than over the net. I live in a town of mostly a very, you know, be respectful to each other culture. But over the net, it's hard to find people who won't just abuse the security of anonymity. And the families and parents of other autistic people that I would talk with on support forums would get extremely hostile towards me, some of these people. And they would put words in my mouth when I'd tell them some of the things that would help me to keep my head clear, or some of the things that I did so that I could, you know, do this, that, or the other thing on my own, or handle this, that, or the other thing on my own, or communicate better with other people. And they'd be like, how dare you say that I'm not doing enough for my child? Or how dare you say that my child isn't doing enough? They're handling this, that, and the other thing. Or they, you know, straight up disbelieve that I had ever even been diagnosed autistic. And I was always so amazed that they would be like that, that they could be so hostile, because I was trying to tell them, hey, I've been through this too. I know what this is. And there's hope. But they would just, a lot of them would just be so invested in their misery and in the misery of their kid. You know, this was something that they had gotten so invested in and so attached to that it was part of them. And if you tried to take that away, it was like they felt that it would invalidate them. I mean, you'd have to ask them, but like I said, I've got an intuition about people. It really looked like they were scared. They were scared to see someone so grounded in their life when they were so sure of the way that things were. And the thing is, back then, people still believed that autism was static. They believed that autism was a static thing. It's not. But because of all that hostility towards me, it kind of put me in hiding for the rest of my adult life up to now. I didn't want to deal with the hostility of autistic people and families of autistic people who were too invested in their paradigm of despair. And I didn't want to deal with so-called normies who would treat me differently once they knew. I didn't want to deal with that. I masqueraded as being normal for over 10 years. Well over 10 years. But back then people still believed that autism was static. It's not. The world has changed in its understanding since then. I saw this thing on Tumblr once where it showed kind of this meme about how the prior understanding of autism had been like it was a thermometer. More employable, more functioning, less intelligent. And it said, this is actually wrong. This is a wrong paradigm. This is not what autism is like. It's not like a thermometer. It's more like an ice cream bar. You've got various different flavors of ice cream. Over here is the good at music. Over there is the good with colors. Over there is the good with analytical skills. Over there is the very bad with analytical skills. And you've got all these different toppings of like a super sensitive sensory intake or a problem with certain colors, a problem with certain sounds or certain smells. And it was true. It was right. There's no linear definitive kit for people who have autism. And I added my two cents that over time, the ice cream and the toppings will melt or meld. They'll change over the hours. Autism is a human condition. And like any other human condition, you know, when you're a child, you may be one thing, but by the time you're an adult, you'll have grown out of some of those things. Some of the things will stay with you. But a lot of things that were true for you as a kid will not be true for you as an adult. Like for me, back when I was a child, I had a real hard time trying to be on the level with other people in conversation. Now I can hold a conversation with people just fine. I mean, I'm a sponsored streamer. I can engage my audience just great. And there are some things that won't even be around permanently. Like to this day, one of the things that has never left me and probably never will leave me is a thing about sound. My brain forms the most connections with sounds. I remember my life like it's a series of playlists. You can play a song and I will vividly recall to mind some part of my life or something in my life that my brain formed connections with while that song was playing or while that song was current on the radio or something. And certain sounds, like I can't go to the movie theater. I can't go to the movie theater because these days sounds are mastered too loud. I can't handle that. I cannot handle sudden loud sounds. I cannot handle extremely loud sounds in general, although I can get pretty loud myself. But yeah, sound is always going to be a thing for me. There will be certain sounds that I can't handle or don't like, or I'll get overwhelmed sometimes by too much audio sensory input. I'll have to mute the music in the game and put on some kind of nature sounds, like with Calm.com. And Calm.com is a lifesaver. It's a lifesaver. Everyone should get a subscription to it. Meditations are really awesome. But I digress. So yeah, when the music and the complex sounds start to overwhelm me, I'll mute them and I'll put on some quiet nature sounds, because silence, I can't handle silence either. Sometimes silence is necessary, but then all the noise in my head starts to overwhelm me. So I have to put on some kind of very soft sound in order to cope. That is something that has always been true of me. That is something that will always be true for me. And a lot of my friends in Guildies didn't even know that this was part of that. That this was part of being an autistic woman for me, an autistic person for me. They just thought it was a thing. They just thought it was a thing, and that's fine. And going back to junior high, when I was about 13, I went through a photophobic phase. Yeah, things for autistic people don't always start out, you know, the way that they were. They grow into things, they grow out of things, just like normal people. Just like you. We grow in and out of things just like you. I went through a photophobic phase where all kinds of light hurt my eyes. It hurt my eyes. I could not stand it. I had to wear sunglasses indoors because of how the light hurt me so bad. And while I was in class sitting with my sunglasses once, one of my classmates, Jacqueline, actually got up from her seat, tore my sunglasses off my face, and started, you know, saying things like, you're fine, it's all in your head, you're fine. And all I could do was cover my eyes and say, Jackie, please, please, give them back, I need them, just please give them back. And finally, she gave them back. She was still kind of flustered at me for being so strange in her presence, but she gave them back because she was, you know, despite that one incident, a decent person. We've lost touch over the years, but I still consider her a friend. But yeah, that's a problem that's been ongoing over the past several years. And that's why I'm doing this video today, because back then, like I said, people had this misconception that autistic life and that autism was static. It's not. It's a human condition like anything else. And this is also why there is no cure for autism. There will never be a cure for autism, because autism is not a disease. In order for there to be a cure for something, it has to be a disease. Autistic people are not diseased. We're human. We're just wired different. We have, you know, different things going on in our brains, and we grow into them and out of them the same as any other human does. Let's see. Yeah. And so, yeah, Hallinvar, my boyfriend, as you all know, Hallinvar is the only person I have told in all these years that I was diagnosed with autism. His reaction was the same as I'm sure probably most of you are today. Oh my God, I didn't know. I never would have guessed. You're so grounded in your life. But I told him because I trusted him. I trusted him and only him enough to tell him. I felt safe telling him. But even with how much I trust him, and I trust him with everything, I only talked about it with him alone and in voice chat. Never in instant messages, never in any copyable or screenshotable way, because that is how much I was still afraid of how people could treat me if they knew, of how so-called normies might change their way of looking at me, interacting with me, or peg down their respect for me, or how other autistic people in their families could get hostile toward me for being so grounded in my life and being proof that there is better for everyone with autism, that any person can grow themselves and live a full life And I will have to tell you right here, ladies and gentlemen, upbringing has everything to do with how a lot of that turns out. The parenting attitude or guardianship attitude of who an autistic person is with has everything to do with that. There's an attitude like my parents had and some other autistic friends of mine. We had this support group that we made together as teenagers called Unique Perspectives. There was me, Aaron, Lauren, Steven. I was surrounded by boys because statistically, autism affects females, biological females, way less than it does males. Way less. So even when I was surrounded by like people, I was still alone. I was the only girl there until like the last half year before I moved out of town. They brought in Corey, who was just a few years younger than me. And she was lovely. I was like, a girl? For me? I'm not going to be alone? Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, she was great. She was lovely. She was kind of like me, full of jokes and wit. And she had amazing hair. Amazing blonde hair that was wavy and naturally golden. Even just remembering it, I think, I want to go back and brush her hair. But yeah, all of our parents had this attitude of transcendence, of you can go beyond what you were born with or stuck with. You can do better. They would communicate to us how we could do better with other people, things we needed to remember about other people, things we needed to not do. Please remember to not do this with other people. Please try to approach something from this way. Or if you're struggling with this, you can try that. That they didn't treat us like we were broken. They always told us that we were capable of better, we could do better, and they expected us to do our damnedest, our utmost. That was their expectation of us, my parents and all my friends' parents who were autistic. And plenty of other people growing up with autism, they don't have that. Their parents or their guardians have this attitude towards them, like they're just some broken thing and that's how they're always going to be. Oh, you have to go easy on them. They're autistic. Oh, they can't help it that they just did this completely unacceptable thing. They're autistic. Oh, it's one of the problems that they have and they're always going to have because they're autistic. And otherwise intelligent people get accommodated this way. Their behaviors get accommodated this way. They don't get told that they have to change. They don't get told that they should change. They don't get told that they even can change, that they're capable of change. They get told that they're never going to change, that no matter what they try or what they do, they're always going to be like this. They're always going to be this little broken thing that everyone just has to understand is broken. And that's bullshit. Because you know what that turns out? That turns out autistic adults who treat their autism like it's the new, the devil made me do it. And I'm going to give you some examples of that because I have encountered that. I am an autistic woman and I am going to tell you about other autistic people who have treated it like it's the devil made me do it, not like it's something that you can do better about. There was this one guy who, as an adult, very awkward, was in a chat room that I had made, and they were very supportive of my writing, but whenever they tried to have conversations with the people in my group, the room got really quiet. Like, they'd be just talking into an echo chamber to themselves because that's how uncomfortable they made everyone. Because they would talk about things that nobody was interested in. They'd talk about, like, we were all talking about games. They were talking about something else that had nothing to do with games. And they would get very personal with their approaches to people. Like, they'd say, they'd single out one person specifically and say, "How are you doing?" "I'm good." "Well, I just want to make sure you're okay. Just want to make sure you're having a good time right now." "Great. Thanks for that rather uncomfortable personal interest in me today." And it was very hard for them, poor thing. And later they came out that you know, to no one's surprise that they were autistic, and that made social interaction very difficult for them. Unfortunately, the way that they presented it was the way that most people present something when they're trying to guilt you into staying with them or being, you know, stay my friend, stay with me, because if you leave me, you're mean and you're giving up on me. That was how it came off. I don't know if that was how they intended it, because believe it or not, autistic people are just as capable of being manipulative as normies are. Trust me, I would know. But that was how it came off. And eventually the chat room was disbanded, and at first they thought it was, you know, just them getting kicked. They thought it was just them getting kicked, and they thought that, you know, some people in the chat room might have had a problem with their autism, and they had the gall to just assume that I was yet another normie who knew nothing about autism, started trying to give me these educational links to read to try to pity them more. That was it. That was what it was. They were looking for pity, hoping that people would be more pitying and understanding of them if they could just be more educated. And I really had to hold myself back from raging at this person. How dare you assume anything about me? How dare you assume that your experience is the same for every autistic person out there? How dare you assume that maybe someone in my family wasn't autistic? How dare you assume that I don't know? Ask first. Ask first. Ask what someone knows about autism before you just go assuming that they don't understand, because every autistic person's life is different. It is different. I am proof of that. I had a much different life from this person. So I don't fault them for not knowing. Ignorance can never be faulted. And I never told them. But it still made me so angry. So angry that they could be so, you know, wrapped up in themselves, which unfortunately is a possible autistic flaw, being so within your own perspective that you can't see anyone else's view. Some autistic people have that, and that's part of the stereotype even. So, yeah, that was one thing. That was one thing that I did not like. How people had not told this person that they could communicate better. And I even tried several times, you know, you need to try communicating this way. And they'd remember none of it, or they wouldn't apply any of it. They'd just say, well, it's just so hard. It's just so difficult. I'm like, yeah, well, I'm telling you how you can make it not difficult. But they never applied that, which baffled me, because grown-ups around me as a girl had told me all the time, you can do better by doing this. And I would take it to heart. This other adult that I was talking to was not taking it to heart, was not listening to me. They'd say, I wish I could do better. And I'm like, okay, well, I can tell you how you can do better. Well, yeah, but it's just so difficult. Great, okay, why even try then? Another autism is the new devil made me do it kind of person that I knew. And a lot of my friends and guildmates will know who I'm talking about, and a lot of friends from Twitter will know who I'm talking about. And if he's watching, the creeper, he'll know who I'm talking about. Another autistic person that I knew who never knew that I was autistic, he was a pervert. He was a charming pervert and a very autistic and depressive pervert. And I was going through a time of my life where I was in this pit of darkness. And at the time, he was there for me. He was the only one that I felt I could unburden myself to, open up to. He was the shoulder that I had to cry on. And we grew closer, but unfortunately, he started making advances. And I was already in a relationship at the time. And this grew to be a problem. His advances became more and more so, to the point that it became a problem. And despite the fact that I fought for this guy, you know, he's not going to do anything, you know, untoward. He can't do anything to me over the net. You know, there's really nothing to worry about. He's just a friend. But it really bothered the person that I was in a relationship with to the point that the ultimatum was given: either you cut this guy out of your life for good, or something's got to change here. So I explained the situation that, hey, your advances have become a problem to the point that the person I'm in a relationship with does not trust you at all, and I have to distance myself from you. I have to cut ties with you. Instead of being understanding, this guy, this autistic guy, got angry at me. Got so angry at me. You know, acted like I felt that he was expendable. Acted like I didn't care about him at all. Which was pretty heartbreaking. Later, and this is the really creepy part, later, he lied his way into a guild that I was very close with. And most of you know the guild. I will not say the exact guild, but most of you know which guild. And he lied his way into the guild. And this is how everyone knows he lied. He told me, once he had joined that guild, that he had no idea that I was so close with them. He had no idea that I was such good friends with everyone in that guild. And that Hollenvar, who was in that guild at the time, as opposed to mine, that Hollenvar had approached him and asked him to join. Come to find out, that was a lie. That was an absolute lie. Because he was still following me on Tumblr from his Not Safe for Work blog. He had unfollowed me with all his other blogs except that one. So he knew that I was posting with this guild. He knew that I was, you know, taking screenshots and hanging out with this guild. He was watching. He also lied about Hollenvar approaching him because he had actually, I found this out from the GM and from Hollenvar, that he had actually gone to the GM and asked to join. He approached them. So that was a lie. And then later, it was found out that on his main blog that had unfollowed me, it had gotten reblogged into my dashboard, he posted a screenshot where he had been, you know, following Hollenvar and me and some other friends on an adventure plot from the sidelines, not announcing his presence. My character name in his screenshot was Light Blue, which meant that my character was on his friends list. Whether or not we were Battletech friends, my character was on his friends list, so he knew exactly what zone I would be in at any given time. So he lied his way into the guild by saying he said he had no idea that I was close with this guild. It was a lie. He said that he had been asked into this guild. It was a lie. He had asked to join it. And he got caught on it. Hollenvar, of course, was not having any of this shit. The GM, of course, was not having any of this shit. And I, of course, was not having any of this shit. And he ended up leaving the server. Later, I found out that he had this art account on Twitter that he used a nude sketch of my character for his avatar. And when I saw that, I just thought to myself, Oh, Christ. I didn't tell him to take it down, to stop using a nude of my character for his avatar, because I didn't want to get into a fight. But yeah, there you have it. Two adults. Both autistic, both quite intelligent, but with very different approaches to life and what is okay and what is not. I know that that kind of behavior is not okay. You all know that that kind of behavior is not okay. He excused it by saying that he was just very attached. Yeah. It's not okay. Guys, the range of variety among autistic adults is as wide as the variety that exists among other adults. And in the argument of autistic versus asshole, you have to understand, if you have tried communicating and saying, this is not okay, please don't do this, then any intelligent person autistic or otherwise, wherever they are in the normie realm or on the autistic spectrum, is very capable of stopping and changing if they want to. I changed because I wanted to. You know, when I was asked, you know, please change this, please don't do that, I did that. Because I knew that, you know, this was someone telling me what is acceptable and what is not. Same with my friends. They listened when someone would tell them that this is acceptable, this is not. Any intelligent person, autistic or otherwise, is capable of stopping and changing if they want to. But if they excuse it and make no change, or try to get you to believe that they shouldn't have to change, you should just understand, you know, they're making completely inconsiderate and insensitive comments, and you call them on it and they say, well, I have autism. Yeah, that is assholery. That is not okay. That is not okay. So, yeah, that is a thing to know about autistic adults. We have plenty of intelligent people. We have plenty of challenged people. But when it comes to the intelligent people, and even to some of the challenged people, you communicate with them. You tell them what is okay and what is not. And if they're a decent person, just like any normie, they will listen. If they are not a decent person, they will not listen. They will excuse it. Just like any normie will excuse it. And I say normie, I hate that word. I hate that moniker, but in terms of having to differentiate between the so-called normal person and the autistic person, you know, for the purposes of this video, it kind of serves, but I really hate it, because I've seen plenty of you normies. You are pretty strange. You are pretty strange. You put some of us autistic people to shame with how strange you can be. Like, there's plenty of you that I know that are stranger than me. Way stranger than me, and there's supposedly nothing even wrong with you. Or at least nothing that you'll admit. Yeah. So, yeah, that's something you guys all need to know. You can't treat an autistic person like they're broken. Like they will always be broken. Like they've always been broken. Like they're not going to change. Because all humans are capable of growing and capable of changing and capable of better. That's what I'm here talking to you about today. I have a full and happy life. I am in a loving relationship. I am a sponsored streamer for Kinesis Gaming. I'm a Twitch affiliate. I lead a wonderful cross-faction guild full of wonderful people. My life is good. My life is good. Your life can be too. Your life can be too, and you can do it on your own. You can. My friend Steven, he turned his family farm from just another farm in our county to one of the biggest tourist attractions in our county, one of the biggest local tourist attractions in our county. There are rides, there is a store, it's amazing what he has done with his farm. He is a really, really good businessman, and he's engaged to this lovely girl that he met in China because he was an exchange student to college in China. Okay? And he's got Asperger's syndrome just like me. My friend Lauren owns his own publishing company, his own animation studio. I voice acted for his audiobooks and his animations. We're all doing great. All of us. You can do great too. The world is yours. The world is yours. It really is. And I will admit that despite all this, I am wondering how people will treat me after seeing this video. I am wondering how people will talk to me after today. If you've treated me as any kind of normal human being, self-accountable to their own behavior, self-aware up to now, keep doing that. Don't you start treating me like I don't still deserve the same regard as anyone else just because you know now. You don't get to act as if everything suddenly changed. Nothing's changed. Everything is still as it was before. I am still me. I am still the Aranya that you know. The only thing that's changed is what you know now since you woke up this morning. I haven't changed at all. I am still the same person you know, so you treat me that way. And if you know anyone else who's autistic, you treat them that way too. Thank you, everyone, for listening to me on World Autism Day 2018. I hope that you understand now. I hope that there is a lot that you have learned from all this today. And I hope you understand why, for so long, I've been afraid to come out with this. I want to thank Hollenvar, my partner in everything. Baby, you're perfect. You understand me. You listen to me. I want to thank my guild, my friends, our allies. I want to thank the Shaw of Happiness. You all know her. She was partly an inspiration for doing this. She's always been very upfront, or at least appeared to be upfront, on Twitter about her challenges. And Chris Metzen, him finally coming out with his anxiety issues, they were an inspiration for having the courage after so many years to do this today. Or part of it, part of that inspiration was also how understanding the community that I'm in seems to have grown to be. More than 10 years ago, it was not this understanding. People were still stuck in this flawed paradigm about what autistic adults are like. And I think the world has changed. I think the world is ready to keep growing and change its paradigm now. So if you are someone who is autistic, or if you know someone who is autistic, please know that life is not dark. Life is not inherently dark. Change can happen. I'm proof of that. My friends are proof of that. The world is yours. So thank you all for listening. Aldiashana. And until next time, get fat loot, stay on the point. Please be excellent to each other. Bye-bye.